Backcountry recreationists often discuss whether or not they should avoid convexities under the current conditions. In this video, Bruce Jamieson and I discuss the role of convexities in human-triggered slab avalanches and their role in art selection. Let's start by looking at a skier-triggered large slab avalanche that was triggered at a convexity. Let's rewind to when the slab avalanche was triggered. Below the skier, we see the first crack through the slab. The crack in the weak layer was likely triggered a second or less before this frame. The skier is in a convex part of the slope, but the skier is also on a steep slope. In this video, we look at the effect of convexities and slope inclines as contributing factor to human triggering. Understanding these factors can help us with route selections in the backcountry.
Many of the slab avalanches that catch and sometimes kill people in the backcountry release on persistent weak layers under a slab. This dry slab avalanche released on a layer of surface ore. Notice that it released on the steeper slope below the convexity. Let's look at how the formation of two types of persistent weak layers often vary on convex slopes. Let's consider convex slopes from the west through north to east. The steeper, more northerly parts of these slopes often receive less solar radiation because they are shaded from the sun. During relatively clear weather, persistent weak layers like surface ore and facets often form on these slopes on or near the snow surface. This can lead to larger surface ore crystals on the steeper part of the more northerly convex slopes. However, on top of the convexity, more solar radiation will reach the snow surface, so surface ore crystals are often smaller or sometimes absent. Wind can also contribute to smaller surface ore crystals on top of the convexity. What about facets that form at or near the snow surface? The same shading and cooling will also tend to form larger facets on the steeper part of the slope and smaller facets on top of the convexity. What is the concern about bigger crystals on the steeper, shadier slopes? Well, once buried by subsequent snowfalls, where the crystals are bigger, the weak layer will be easy to trigger and prone to propagate cracks in the weak layer. Also, the weak layer will persist longer where the crystals are bigger. Okay, maybe I exaggerated the size of the faceted crystals, but you get the idea. Here's an example on a convex northwest facing slope. The numbers are scores from rich block tests, which is a test for unstable slabs. The scores of 1, 2, and 3 lower on the slope indicate instability. These rich blocks released on a buried layer of surface ore down 50 to 60 centimeters. Near the top of the slope, where my colleague and I got 2 4s and a 5, which are more indicative of stability, the surface ore layer could not be found. While doing these tests, we suspected that wind inhibited the growth of surface ore crystals high on the convex part of the slope. But persistent weak layers are not always more developed and weaker on steeper, shadier slopes than on sunny slopes or on top of convexities. For example, if we get a week or two of cold, clear weather in early or midwinter, the upper snowpack will become faceted on all aspects, including on top of convexities. And where the snowpack is shallow during the cold, clear weather, depth ore may form deep in the snowpack, everywhere from broad ridges to steep slopes on all aspects. And there are other exceptions. So, buried surface ore and near surface facets are often, but not always, easy to trigger on the steep, shady slopes below convexities. Next, Ron is going to explain how the mechanics of cracks in weak layers contribute to human triggering on steep slopes below convexities.
Understanding where avalanches are typically trigger forms and where the parameters are can help us manage the risk on these slopes. The balance between the forces pulling the slab down the slope, the slab bed surface friction, and the slab tensile strength dictate where avalanches' crown walls are formed. This balance changes with slope angle. In this image, the green arrows are proportional to the friction, and the red arrows are proportional to the gravitational force. As we can see, the friction decreases and the downslope pull increases with slope angle. The maximal tensile strength of the slab depends on the slab bed surface friction. For persistent weak layer, it is about 30 degrees slope, with hard slab avalanches typically pulling deeper into the flats. Convexities by nature are more exposed to the wind than the slope above or below them. As a result, the wind tends to transport the snow from the convexity roll into another section of the slope. This leaves the slab on the convexity roll both thinner and weaker. Avalanche crown walls are formed above the slab tensile failure, where the friction exceeds the downslope gravitational force. If we consider what we talked about in this video, we can see why the crown walls are typically end up on the convexity roll. We heard from Bruce why the snowpack on steep northeast and west slopes is more likely to develop persistent weak layer than the flat part of the convexity. However, there are also mechanical reasons why avalanches are more likely to be triggered from a steep slope. To understand why, let's start with a quick review of how dry slab avalanches start. A dry slab avalanche starts when a skier load breaks a weak snowpack layer under the cohesive slab. If the weak layer failure under the skier is large enough, crack propagation along the weak layer starts. We call the minimum failure size that leads to crack propagation the critical cut length. The critical cut length depends on snowpack properties in the terrain. As it turns out, it gets smaller with slope angle. As the crack propagates through the weak layer, it undercuts the slab support. And finally, if gravitational force overcomes friction, the snow slab eventually fracture and slide. The intensity and the size of the skier load on the weak layer dictates the initial failure. The length of the weak layer failure under the skier is called the skier crack length. In this image, the rail bob illustrates the contour of the shear stress under the skier. If the skier crack length is larger than the critical cut length, crack propagation along the weak layer starts. The picture on the left shows the weak layer failure under a load of a skier. The skier crack length in this picture is smaller than the critical cut length. Consequently, there was no crack propagation along the weak layer. Due to geometry, the skier crack length increases with slope angle. The white arrows represent the skier crack length on flat and 37 degree slope. You can see the side-by-side comparison of the skier crack length on those slopes on the lower left side of the screen. The chart on the right side shows how the critical cut length and the skier cut length change with slope angle. As we can see, the critical cut length decreases and the skier cut length increases with slope angle. Therefore, the overall odds of triggering an avalanche increase with slope steepness.
Let's look at the recent research on convexities and human triggering. In this study, of over 500 start zones triggered by skiers, von Tobel and colleagues found that most avalanches were triggered on planar slopes, as shown in this photo, or on concave slopes. Convex slopes were notable by their absence. The frequency of triggering increased strongly with slope angle from 30 to 40 degrees, which is similar to previous studies. Many avalanches were triggered in shallow gullies. This 2018 Swiss study developed a GIS-based method for mapping avalanche terrain. They found that uniform or slightly concave slopes with slope angles around 35 degrees were most prone to human triggering, whereas convex and irregular steeper slopes were less often release zones. But convexities were assumed to have a role in remote triggering. For remote triggering from below release zones, propagation upwards was assumed to stop at convexities. Want to see that cheesy animation again? Yeah, I thought so. Ron has explained why crown fractures often occur at convexities. This Canadian study analyzed how the terrain choices of heli-ski guides varied with the avalanche hazard. At higher hazard levels, the guides avoided steeper slopes, concave slopes, and, to a lesser degree, convex slopes. So these three recent studies suggest increased human triggering on steeper slopes more so than at convexities. However, my friends who are ski guides are clear that avoiding convexities at higher levels of avalanche hazard is an important way in which they reduce avalanche risk. So I asked Scott Thumlert why guides identify or interpret convexities differently from these studies. He is the first author of this study, a ski guide and consultant. The three studies all use digital elevation models with resolutions ranging from 5 to 20 meters. Scott, do you think guides and these research studies identify convexities differently?
I think so. And again, I'm not exactly sure the full effect of that resolution difference. Other than that, I know from experience guiding and also from engineering planning work that the higher resolution, sort of in the 2 meter to 5 meter, you are able to really pick up and identify, you know, terrain features that are, you know, very relevant for avalanche formation. Whereas the lower resolution, sort of 10 to 20 meter, those do miss a lot of the subtleties in the terrain that are important for avalanches.
By avoiding convexities, are ski guides also avoiding the steep slopes below them?
Yes, definitely. Certainly the slope steepness is the most important parameter that guides are you know, avoiding when there's a when there is an avalanche hazard in the snowpack. And then so, yeah, by subsequently, they are avoiding convexities.
In a related conversation, a very experienced guide, Mark Pichet, noted that compared to steep planar slopes, convexities are easier to identify from a distance, in flat light, or from different angles. So there is a partial explanation of the different interpretation of convexities by ski guides and the research studies. Next, Ron is going to look at the role of convexities and slope angle in ski cutting.
Now that we understand where and why most avalanches on a convex slope break and trigger, we can also assess the risk as we descend the slope. Since the avalanche crown is typically at the convex wall, the further down the slope we are when we trigger an avalanche, the larger the volume of snow that avalanche above us, and therefore larger the risk. Other than avoidance, ski cutting is the only way to manage the avalanche hazard in the backcountry. Ski cutting can be very dangerous, and this is not a recommendation for ski cutting. But if you decide to take the risk, we recommend that you revisit Bruce's ski cutting video, and we have a few points for you to consider before you're accepting the risk. We asked Scott where he typically ski cuts on a convex slope.
Sweet spot for ski cutting is probably just below the convexity and the steepest part of the slope. In terms of lower risk, yeah, the ski cutter just has to ensure that the slab doesn't release above their skis and then they get caught in the moving snow.
The color of this slope represents how safe it is avalanche-wise. As we can see, recognizing the sweet spot for ski cutting on sharp convexities is pretty straightforward. This is not the case on gradual convexity. It is easy to get sucked too low into the slope and trigger an avalanche well above you.
It's a lot easier to position that ski cut if the convexity is a sharp transition rather than a gradual convexity where it's a little more difficult to identify the effective part and also the safe or low risk place to.
A special case is when a convexity is a mid-slope. These convexities are sometimes too small to stop an avalanche from propagating up the slope and flowing over the convexity zone. Mid-slope convexities, especially under hard slab condition, prove to be deadly even for experienced professional avalanche workers. A notable example was the avalanche that took the life of three ski patrollers in the Highland Bowls in March 31st, 1984. Hard slab avalanches tend to propagate well into the flat sections of the convexity, In other words, regardless of the convexity shape, there is no good place to ski cut hard slabs. In fact, all other professionals that we know of avoid ski cutting hard slabs altogether, and we suggest that you avoid it too.
Before answering the question about avoiding convexity, let's review the key points. Terrain popular with backcountry recreationists includes many convex, concave, and planar slopes. Suppose our route is on the right side of this photo. Triggering is most likely on the steep slopes here and here. That is because of the way skiers crack weak layers, because cracks in weak layers propagate efficiently upslope, and because persistent weak layers are often weaker and easier to trigger on steep, shady slopes below convexities than high on convexities. Especially from a distance, or when the light is flat, the way the light changes on a convexity can help us recognize the steep slope below it. Crown fractures are often on convexities, more often on the lower, steeper part of the convexity. In this video clip, the skier is on the gradual convexity when he triggered the slab. The crack in the weak layer propagated up the gradual convexity. Fortunately, very fortunately, the skier was at the edge of the moving slab when he was left behind. Had he been carried into the gully, the forces and potential consequences would have been much higher. Usually, being on the highest part of a convexity is low risk. However, in this photo, a hard slab was on top of a widespread persistent weak layer. The crack in the weak layer propagated unpredictably upslope to the top of the convexity. As Ron mentioned, sometimes such propagations can cross a gentle bench, pulling the slab down over the convexity. When avalanche bulletins mention that propagations like this are occurring, I avoid avalanche terrain. Often I head to esquire or Nordic trails. So let's add this point. Rarely, an avalanche can pull a slab from the top of a convexity, and very rarely from above a gentle bench. This video started with this question about whether to avoid convexities. Here are my thoughts about the terrain in this photo. At low or moderate danger, when persistent or hard slabs are not expected, I would probably do an extended column or other instability test around here. Then, if there were no surprises in the snowpack, I would ascend this short convex slope here and descend by the same slope or this short convex slope here. Although these slopes are convex and steep enough to slide, they are small slopes with a gradual runout and no terrain traps. At considerable or higher danger, I would exclude this terrain at the trip planning stage because there are too few options to avoid the steeper slopes. But this is just one piece of terrain under specific conditions. In general, the main terrain characteristics that I tend to avoid when the avalanche danger is considerable are slopes that are steep enough and big enough to produce a size D2 avalanche, slopes above terrain trap, and terrain with few options to avoid such slopes. Convexities help me identify slopes that are steep enough to slide. The snowpack factors I consider include the avalanche problem type, the hardness, and thickness of the slab. Because of the complex interaction between terrain and snowpack factors, we recommend that backcountry recreationists develop their terrain and decision-making skills from recreational avalanche courses and from backcountry travel with experienced people. Thanks for watching. Feel free to disagree with the ideas in this video. Let's have a discussion in the comments section below. Thanks to these people for their insightful comments that improved this video.